invite you to come tripping the 60s with us this evening. We just sing a bunch of songs that many of our friends wrote, sang, recorded. Many of our friends aren't here anymore. They are at the left of the planet. So we sing your songs to keep them alive in our own hearts and to keep the music alive in your hearts. And we're going to start right where I started back in 1963. I got with a friend of mine, Randy Sparks. I was working in a group that he had called the New Christy Minstrels, and we wrote this song. I recorded it with him. It was my first gold record. It goes like this. It was so bad by the time he'd get his guitar out of a case, get it tuned up, everybody in the coffee house there in Greenwich Village, they all left. They didn't want to hear him sing. But then somebody heard the words he was writing, and the songs he was singing, and this guy's music changed the course of music in America forever. We're going to do two of his songs right here. Come gather around people wherever you go, and admit that the waters around you have grown, and accept that too soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a soul. For the tide, they are a changer. Senators and congressmen, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't block up the hall. For he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. There's a battle outside and it's raging. It'll soon shake your windows and rattle your walls. For the time they are a change. How many roads must a man walk down before they call him a man?
many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? And how many times must cannonballs fly before they're far out the band go? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing.
Come on, it's your turn. It's who you think.
And how many deaths will it take till he knows that too many people have died? The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
All right, your turn once again. Bob Dylan songs. So I quit that group. I went out to Los Angeles looking for a recording contract. And I met a friend of ours out there, Roger McGuinn. He just put a group together. And he gave me a ride across town one afternoon. He was telling me about he had a single coming out in about 2 weeks. And how does it go? So he's driving along. I'm sitting in the passenger seat, you know, and he's singing a cappella to me driving down La Cienega Boulevard. And it was a Bob Dylan tune. In fact, it was the very tune I wanted to record, and he beat me to it. I couldn't. Well, it was about a week and a half later, they were opening night, Ciro's, Hollywood, California. And they're all up on stage. Roger and Dave Crosby, Gene Clark, Chris Hillman. They're all up there playing and singing the Birds, the first time anybody had ever heard them. And I was on the dance floor dancing. The place was packed out. Well, I wasn't really dancing. There were so many people there. You were like this. That was it. I was dancing. And this is what I was dancing to.
Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me. I'm not sleepy yet. There ain't no place I'm going to.
Come on, you know the words.
Hey, Mr. Tambourine. Song for me in the jingle jangle morning. I'll come follow you.
Hold your picnic for a trip upon that magic swirly ship. All my senses have been stripped,
and my hands can't feel to grip, and my toes too numb to step.
Waiting only for my boot heels to be worn.
Well, I'm ready to go anywhere. I'm ready for to fade unto my own parade. Cast your gaze and spell my way. I promise to go under it. Play a song for me. I'm not sleepy yet. There ain't no place I'm going to. Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me. In the jingle jangle morning, I'll come by. circle and a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to gain, a time to lose, a time to rent, a time to sow, a time for love, a time for hate, a time for peace. I swear it's not too late.
Come on, John. So I kind of danced over that direction. And I got to the side of the crowd, and there's a booth over there. There's about four or five guys sitting there. And one of them is a guy named Lou Adler. He's a record producer. He says, "Are you recording?" "Oh, no. What would you like to be?" "Yeah, that's why I came to Los Angeles." He said, "Well, sit down." So I sat down at the table. There's a young guy, 19 years old. His name was Phil Sloan, P.F. Sloan. He had a notebook full of songs, brand new songs. He'd just written them. So I took the notebook home with me, worked on the tunes, and about a week later, I was in the studio. We had a four-hour recording session. We'd done a couple of songs. We had 20 minutes left. That's all we had left. And there was a band out in the hall waiting to come in, so we couldn't stay overtime. So I said, "What should we do?" And I said, "Let's do this tune. I really like this tune." I pulled the words out of my back pocket and smoothed the wrinkles out, hung it on the music stand. We recorded it. In one take. That's all we had time for. One take. That's all I got. Oh. Yeah, the Eastern world, it is exploding. Violence flaring, bullets loaded. Heroes enough to kill, but not promoting. You don't believe in war, or what's the gun you told? And even the Jordan River has bodies floating. And you tell me over and over and over again, my friend, if you don't believe, we're on the eve of destruction. Oh, I know you understand what I was trying to say. I know you feel the fears I'm still feeling today. When the button is pushed, there'll be no running away. I never know what to say for the world in a gray. Take a look around you, boy. It's bound to scare you, boy. And you tell me over and over and over again, my friend. And you don't believe we're on the eve of destruction. Yeah. You know my blood's so mad, it's like coagulating. Standing here just contemplating. You can't twist the truth, it knows no regulation. And a handful of senators can pass legislation. And marches alone will never bring integration. When you are respected, disintegrate. Ah, this whole crazy world is just too frustrating. And you tell me over and over. Think of all the hate, still living inside us. It's never too late to let love guide us. Oh, we can leave him for a lifetime in space, but if we return, find the same old place. All the pounding of the drums, the quiet disgrace. We can bury our dead and don't leave a trace. Hit our next door neighbor, but don't forget to say grace. Tell me over and over. And over again, my friend. You don't believe we're still on the eve of destruction. Yeah. You don't believe we're still on the eve of destruction. When will we ever? When? And you know, like I say, we recorded it in 5 minutes. We only had, you know, just 20 minutes left. The band went through it a couple times. We pushed the button, had time to listen to it one time. Then we had to leave the studio. We thought we'd go back the following week and redo it. But there never was a following week. We recorded on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. I got a telephone call from the record company. Hey, McGuire, turn on KFWB. It was a big rock and roll station in LA at that time. So I turned the radio on, it's about 6 o'clock in the morning, and here's this, you tell me over and over on the radio. I never got to go back and re-record it. So that was how it happened. And people called it a protest song. And it wasn't protesting anything. I mean, you know, it was just a bunch of newspaper headlines set to a melody. There was nothing in the song that everybody had already read in the newspaper. You know? And they called me a protest singer. And I wasn't protesting anything. I mean, if you have a car, it's not running right, and you take it to a mechanic, and you say, check out my car, something's wrong. So you come back in maybe 2 hours, and he says, oh, I've looked it over, I've run a diagnostic on it, and the engine is shot. You need a new engine. Well, you don't go tell all of your friends that he's a protest mechanic. He just diagnosed your engine. You need a new engine. And that's what even destruction was. It was like a societal diagnosis of worldwide hypocrisy. The human race needed a new engine. You know, I needed a new engine. But I didn't know where to find it. I didn't know any answers. There were no answers in the song. I'm working on my album, my second album with Dunhill. And I got a telephone call one afternoon from a friend of mine who'd come out from New York. Her name is Cass Elliott. Remember Mama Cass? Well, she wasn't Mama Cass then, she was just Cass. And she said, hey, McGuire, I'm out here with some friends, and we're singing a bunch of great songs, man. You gotta come up to the house and hear these songs. So I said, oh, okay, where are you living? So she told me her address. I jumped on my, I had a Royal Enfield 750, got a brown paper bag full of herbal medicine under my arm, you know. Up the hill I go, be careful not to drop your herbs, you know. And I got up to her, I walked in the front door, and there they all are sitting on the floor. There's John Phillips, Michelle Phillips, Denny Doherty. Cass is over here ironing a dress, you know. And I walk in with my bag of herbs. They had a newspaper all spread out on the floor for me. I dumped the herbs in the newspaper. And they're sitting on the floor. There's not a stick of furniture in the house. I mean, there's no beds, no chairs, no couches, nothing. They were flat broke. They had no money, zip, no dollars. I mean, I had a hit record. I was doing okay. But I didn't have any furniture either. Well, we didn't use furniture in those days. I mean, you know, we always sat on the floor. Even if there was a couch, we wouldn't sit on it. We'd sit on the floor. I guess we figured, because, you know, we're going to fall out of the thing about 3 o'clock in the morning, might bunk our head when we hit the floor. So we might as well start off on the floor, that way we don't hurt ourselves, you know. But anyway, they were all sitting there, and I said, hey, John, what's this music you guys are singing? So he got his guitar, and they started to sing. Now, I thought, when I heard the birds for the first time, man, it was a whole step up in music. I mean, I'd never heard anything like them before. But man, when I heard the mamas and papas singing up at Cass's house that night, I had never heard anything. And I thought I had died and gone to musical heaven. I thought, this is it. There is no more beyond this, you know? This is what I heard. All the leaves are brown. And the sky is gray.
And the sky is gray.
Still be here.
Monday. Can't trust that day. Monday, Monday, sometimes it just turns out that way. On Monday morning, you gave me no warning of what was to be. On Monday, Monday, how could you leave and not take me?
But John wrote all these songs, you know, John Phillips. He was a great songwriter. And I think he really surprised himself. I don't think he had any idea he was going to write all these hit songs. You know, you don't know before you write a hit song that it's going to be a hit song. You just sit down and you write what's in your heart, what you feel, the music makes you happy, and then they'd record it and be another hit song. And one day John came over to Denny's house. I was staying with Denny at the time. And I didn't know I was going to be staying with Denny. Now, I wasn't supposed to be staying with him, but I had a new girlfriend, and I was driving around, and I had a yellow 1963 Volkswagen van, panels all closed in, no windows, had a bed in the back. It was my little hippie mobile. I loved it. Yeah. And I had this new girlfriend, and I was taking her around, showing her where all my friends lived. And I just happened to be driving down the Appian Way. That's where Denny lived there in Hollywood. And when there was his house, I said, oh, and there's Denny Doherty's house. So my girlfriend, she's looking up, and right at that moment, then he had this little door in his big front door, a little window, and he had it open. He was peeking out, I don't know, see if the newspaper was there or something. He's looking, and he saw me out at the curb in my VW. Hey, McGuire, is that you? Yeah! Well, come on in! So I grabbed my girlfriend by the hand. I said, come on, come on. So we drug her out of there, up into the house. We went. We stayed there a year and a half. 18 months at Denny's house. I mean, it was the 60s, you know? No one was in a hurry. What's the rush? So one day I'm sitting there, and like I said, John Phillips came over. He was on the couch. I'm watching TV, and Denny and John were talking. They were drinking Crown Royal whiskey and smoking marijuana, and, you know, it's the typical afternoon in the life. And he had a big piano behind the couch there, a big grand piano Denny did, and Scott McKenzie was sitting at the piano bench. And so Denny was, John was kind of thinking, it seems like every time I turn around, I write another hit song. And he said, it seems like I could just write a hit song whenever I want to. And Denny got right in his face, nah, you can't either, man, that's full of it. You're full of it, man, you can't write a hit song whenever you want to. And John said, I could write a hit song right now if I wanted to. Denny said, I'll bet you $500 you can't write a hit song right now. Well, I'll take that bet. Give me your guitar. So Denny reached around behind his chair, grabbed his guitar, handed it to John. John started playing some chords and fiddled around with the strings. Let me see, what should I write about? Let me see. And Scott was sitting at the piano bench. He says, hey, John, you know, he says, all these kids coming to California, coming to the West Coast, you know, and nobody knows who they are. Why don't you write a song that will just kind of let all the folks know that they're good kids? So John thought, oh, what a good idea. Let me think. Tinkle, tinkle, tinkle. And he goes, if you're going to San Francisco, be sure to wear flowers in your hair. If you come to San Francisco, you're gonna find some gentle people there. All across the nation, such a strange vibration. People in motion, there's a whole generation with a new explanation. People in motion. Yeah, people in motion. And if you come to San Francisco, be sure to wear flowers in your hair. And if you come to San time will be a loving. And It comes and it goes, they say.
Looking at?
This is what I look like every morning when I get out of the shower.
Not quite.
See, what are we doing now? Oh, man. One afternoon,
then he said to me, hey, I got a friend coming out from Coconut Grove, Florida. Wait till you hear this guy sing. He says, he's got the best voice you've ever heard. Well, I thought Denny had the best voice in the world. I mean, he had that Irish tenor from Halifax, Nova Scotia. God, when Denny would sing, the birds would hang their head in shame. I mean, little birds in the trees, they'd fall out of the tree. Punk, they'd never sing again, because Denny's voice just put him to shame. So if he thought this guy sounded good, I thought, man, he must really be good. But I didn't know who he was. About 2 days later, a taxi cab pulled up in front of Denny's house. This tall, skinny guy gets out of the taxi cab, and he comes dragging his guitar behind, boom, up the stairs, into the front door, and up to his room. He stays in there 3 days, all jet-lagged out from flying from East Coast to West Coast. And then he walks out, he says, okay, I'm ready to record. So then he got on the phone. He called the limo service. No taxi cabs now. Called the limo, man. Up came a big stretch limousine. It's about 9 meters long. I mean, biggest, I've never seen a car that long. You could land an airplane on the roof. I mean, it was just incredible. And there were about 8 or 9 people at Denny's house that day. So I said, I got to hear this guy sing. So we all went out and piled in the back of the limo. Down to the studio we went. He walked in. It was a big, huge, empty room. Looked like you could park a 747 aircraft liner in there. Huge room. One little stool right in the middle with a light and a microphone. And he sat down on the stool, pulled out his 12-string guitar. That's when I first fell in love with a 12-string, when I heard this guy record. And he started playing his guitar. And I was over in the corner. I was just standing in the shadows there, just listening and dancing as he sang. He recorded 2 songs that day. We'll sing both of them right here. This is the first one he did. This old world may never change. Way that it's been, all the ways of war won't change it back again. I keep searching for the dolphin in the sea, yeah, sometimes I wonder, do you ever think of me? I ain't the one to tell this old world, yeah, how to get along. All I know, that peace will come. All the hate is gone. I keep searching for the dolphin in the sea. Yeah, sometimes I wonder, I can't help but wonder, do you ever think of me? I think about old sadness, child. think about all those days. We went running wild, but I keep searching for the dolphins in the sea. Yeah, sometimes I wonder, I can't help but wonder. Oh yeah, I wonder, do you ever think of me? Do you ever think of me? Okay, well, now here's another song that the same guy wrote and recorded that day. I was there when it happened. And you, I know you know this one, because this is an incredible song. Everybody's talking. Can't hear a word they're saying. Only the echoes on my mind. People stop and stare. I can't see their faces. Only the shadow of their eyes. Come on. Going where the sun comes shining. Through the pouring rain, going where the weather suits my clothes. Banging off of the northeast wind, sailing on a summer breeze, skimming over the ocean like stone.
Wonderful song. He said he wrote that one out.
afternoon. He'd been sailing all Sunday afternoon in the Gulf of Mexico. And he was sailing back into the, you know, west coast of Florida. And it was a sunny afternoon, and it was just a light breeze blowing, there sailing downwind. And he had his guitar and had his shirt off, the sun was on his shoulders, and he just wrote that song. Everybody's talking. It's just, you know, one of those magic little moments in his life. He's gone now. If you ever want to hear what it should sound like, just go home, get on your internet, and go to YouTube, and type in Everybody's Talking, Fred Neil. He's the guy who wrote it. And click on, and you'll hear a guy's voice, and unbelievable. So anyway, one morning I woke up, I was at Cass Elliott's house. In fact, I was there quite a bit, because my yellow Volkswagen van used to get me there early in the morning. I'd be out, you know, somewhere on the beaches, Santa Monica, Huntington Beach, Redondo, someplace, and they'd kick me out of a bar about 4 o'clock in the morning, go home! So, and I don't know how I'd wake up in Cass's driveway. It was incredible. And this one morning, I stepped out of the car and I started heading for the back door, because she always had food in the fridge, and I was looking to have a little breakfast. It was about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, crack of noon, I got up, you know. And I head for the back, and then I saw a guy sitting over at the swimming pool, sitting on the edge of the pool, had his pant legs rolled up and his shoes were off, and he had his feet in the water. Splish, splash, he was taking a bath, just sitting there. And he had a pad of paper on his lap and a pencil. So it was my John Sebastian. I hadn't seen him in a while. Hey, John. So I walked over, sat down next to him. He had a little plastic bag of herbal medicine there next to him, so I helped myself. All pretty good stuff, you know. And we're sitting there talking. He's working. He's writing a song. Well, John Sebastian wrote so many songs. He was always writing songs. Always. I didn't pay much attention to it. I think, another Sebastian tune. Who needs it, you know? This is it. This is the song. Give it up, see?
What a day for a daydream. Yeah.
Custom made for a daydreaming boy.
I'm lost in my daydream.
Dreaming about my bundle of joy.
And even if time is really on my side, it's one of those days for taking a walk outside. I'm blowing the day to take a walk in the sun. Woo! Follow my face in somebody's blue mode now. Sun. Follow my face in somebody's new mode now. I've been having a sweet dream.
Been dreaming since I woke up today.
Starring me and my sweet thing.
She's the reason I'm feeling this way.
And even if time ain't ready on my side, it's one of those days for taking a walk outside. I'm going to day to take
a walk in the sun.
Follow my face in somebody's new mode now.
Well, it was a better song than I thought. About a month later, I heard it on the radio, and I've been listening to it now for 50 years. You know? Good song. Anyway, I was sitting there with John, we were talking, I was, you know, getting into his herbs, and Castelli stuck her head out of the kitchen window. Hey, McGuire, telephone call, New York City. Well, what do you want? Well, let me tell you, Cass was a New York City lady. And I don't know if you know any New York City ladies, but they have an attitude. You never tell them what to do, ever. You ask them politely, and they may do it, they may not. But what I should have said was, what is it they wish to speak with me about, Cassie? I didn't say that. What do I want? Well, her face turned bright pink. Her eyes got real beady, staring back and forth. You know, she disappeared back into the kitchen. I'm sitting there talking with John. First thing she comes back, sticks her head back out there. They're doing a Broadway musical called Hair, and they want you to come back and play the male lead in the Broadway production. I don't know Hair. So I asked John, he's from New York. Hey, what's Hair all about? Oh, he says it's kind of the hippie scene that was happening in Greenwich Village a couple of years ago, and they had an off-Broadway show, and now they're going to take it uptown and make a big Broadway musical out of it. A couple of years ago, God, I don't want to do what's happening a couple of years ago. I said these words. I don't want to do what's happening a couple of years ago, man. I want to do what's happening now. I mean, I'm a now kind of guy. I'm today, I'm happening. I'm Barry McNowell. That's who I am, you know? So I yelled out the cast, tell them I'm not interested. Well, that did it, man. I mean, it was like a cannonball hit her in the back of the head. And her head exploded. I mean, her eyes turned into two great big red strawberries. Flames came out of her nose. Smoke came out. She turned into the Dragon Lady. You come and tell them I'm not your damn secretary. Oh, okay. So I got out of the pool, dried my feet on the grass, walked around into the back door. She's doing dishes, grumbling. I'm the secretary. Who do you think I am? I'm saying, don't be so She said, why don't you go back to New York, girl? They're going to give you a free round trip ticket. Fly you back there, fly back to California. Go back, see everybody. You haven't been there in a couple of years. Have a good time. I said, what a great idea. So I got on the phone. Yeah, okay, yeah. LAX, yeah. Kennedy Airport. Be there day after tomorrow. So I flew back to New York, went to the office there, read the script of the play, and listened to the music. Yeah, I can do this. This is great. I can do this show. So 4 weeks of rehearsal. I opened on Broadway. Did this song 8 times a week. We did 8 shows a week at 2 matinee days. And this is what I sang. They asked me why. I'm just a hairy guy. I know. I'm hairy noon and night. Hair that's a fright. I'm hairy high and low. Don't ask me why. Don't know. It's not for lack of bread, like the Grateful Dead. Darling, give me a head of hair. Long, beautiful hair. Flowing, glowing, steaming, flaxen, waxen. Give me down to their head. Shoulder length and longer. Here, baby, there, mama. Everywhere, daddy, daddy, hey. Bees, the nest for birds, the thing that works, the beauty, splendor, the wonder of my head. But short, long as I can grow in my hair. I want it long, straight, curly, fuzzy, snacky, shaggy, ratsy, faxy, oily, greasy, greasy, shiny, gleaming, steaming, waxy, waxy, not polka dotted, twisted, beaded, braided, powdered, flowered, and very spangled, tangled, spangled, and spaghetti. They'll be gaga to go go when they see me in my toga. My toga made of blonde, British heat, and my hair like Jesus wore it. Hallelujah, I adore it. Hallelujah, Mary, love her son. Why don't my mother love me? Hey. Take a little break. I'm gonna go get another towel and put it on dry, dry shirt. But what I want you to do is work on those words, okay? Because we're going to do it again when we come back. That was just a warm-up. And we had to put some microphones in here this afternoon, so we want to record you all singing live, okay? Now, here's the words. You ready? One deep breath. I want it long, straight, curly, fuzzy, snaggy, shaggy, rancid, messy, oily, greasy, fleecy, shiny, gleaming, steaming, flexing, waxing, knotted, poking, dotted, twisted, beaded, braided, powdered flour and confetti, bangle, tangle, spangle, that spaghetti. Okay? You got it. All right. We'll see you in 15 minutes. Thank you. Song, but I didn't understand really where he was coming from with it until about 2 years ago. My wife and I, she's out selling CDs. If you want to say hello to her and buy a CD, that would, she'd love that. She's from New Zealand. My wife's a Kiwi girl. But anyway, about 2 years ago, we invited our granddaughters came over to spend the night, and it was so cool. I don't know if you have any granddaughters, but granddaughters will steal your heart, man. I mean, it's just. So, and my wife went to the video store. She got a video of Hairspray, a movie called Hairspray. Anybody here seen Hairspray, the movie? Yeah. Really, it's a fun. I didn't want to see it though because I'm a guy. And it's kind of a girl movie. I like, you know, I like science fiction, Star Trek, Indiana Jones, bum ba da ba, bum ba da, you know, stuff like that. I don't want to see Hairspray. But my granddaughter grabbed me by the hand. Come on, Papa, watch the movie with us. Oh no, honey, you go ahead. I want to see it. No, no, come on, Papa, you gotta watch the movie with me. Okay, so he took me by the hand into the living room, sat down on the couch, he turned on the TV, away we went with Hairspray. Well, it didn't take 5 minutes and I was in love with the movie. It was just the most wonderful, fun movie I've ever seen. John Travolta plays a lady in it. And after 3 minutes, you don't even know he's a lady. I mean, it's just incredible. And about 30 minutes, 40 minutes into the movie, my granddaughters got up, both of them, and started dancing. They're like, you know, 6 and 8, and they started dancing. Well, then they said, come on, Papa, dance with us. Well, I didn't want to dance. I'm laying on the couch. No, no, come on, Papa, dance with us. Come on, Nanny, you two, dance with us. So they drug my wife and I off the couch, and we started dancing. And the music is going on in the show, Hairspray, and we're dancing, and it's so much fun, I can't believe how much fun I have. And then they jumped up on the coffee table, my two granddaughters. And they start dancing on the coffee table. Well, my wife won't let me put my feet on the coffee table. But the girls, they can dance on it, that's cool. And they were up there, man, they were going for it, like they were on stage, and they're dancing and swinging, and they broke the leg on the coffee table. It's like this now, you know? And I'll never fix it. Never fix it. Every time I walk to the living room and I see that coffee table, it reminds me of that wonderful moment we had dancing together when we were watching. I'll be 100 years old, that coffee table is still going to be like that, you know. But when I saw my granddaughters come alive to the rock and roll music, I mean, just innocent, joy, fun, dance, wiggle, oh, it's just wonderful. I realized what John Sebastian was going for when he wrote this tune. Woo! In the young girl's heart, how the music can free her. There it starts, and it's a magic. It feels it's groovy. It makes you feel happy like an old time movie. I tell you about the magic, it'll free your soul. It's like trying to tell a stranger about a rock and roll. Do you believe in magic? Well, don't you bother to choose if it's just bad music or rhythm and blues. Just listen. Start with a smile and wipe off your face. No matter how hard you try, your feet are starting to move. You can't seem to find how you got there. Well, it'll blow your mind. Do you believe in me? Well, come along with me. And we'll go to dancing, baby, then you'll see. And baby, if the music is right, I'll keep on dancing till the morning light. Go on dancing, baby, then you'll see. Yeah. Do you believe in magic? leaving and come on with me. Permission to marry that guy over there and go dragging around the world with him, you know. So what I'd like to do, just, you know, for her sake and for her parents' sake in Japan, is I'd like to have her take a photo of everywhere we go, you know, of the wildlife, you know, here in Holland, right? So we're going to picture the wildlife picture. So Sim, if you step right up here, please. Can you bring the house lights up for this? It'll help, you know. Ah, there we are. And so she's going to take three pictures, one here, and one over here. And then we'll tell you what we're going to do with it. Okay, so everybody over here, wave to her parents in Osaka.
Konnichiwa!
Konnichiwa! Konnichiwa! Very good, very good, very good. Okay, now the women now has got to recharge the battery. Hi, okay.
Konnichiwa!
Konnichiwa! Okay, now over here on this side.
Konnichiwa!
Now what we're going to do with that photo is we have a webmaster in Australia, and we're going to email it down there, probably tomorrow or the next day, and then he's going to glue them all together, the magic of Photoshop, and make one big picture out of it, and we're going to post it on our blog page, trippinthe60s.com, on the blog page. So your face will be on our blog page, you know, just a couple of weeks now. So you might, if you want to look and see it. So I really hope you're here with who you're supposed to be here with tonight. But the whole world is going to see you when you're here.
If not, please send $100 to Barry McGuire, Los Angeles, California. And we will do something. What will we do with Photoshop?
Yeah, we'll take your face up and put Arnold Schwarzenegger's face in there. I mean, you know, Arnold, he's just having fun. Anyway. Where are we? Okay, I was always, and back in the 60s, I was always winding up in places. I didn't know how I got there, I didn't know where I was, and I didn't know who I was with. A room full of people, and I didn't know one of them.
It's kind of like this.
Kind of like here tonight. Very much. But anyway, this one time, it's about 3 o'clock in the morning, that's when we started re-entering space-time continuum. And I was sitting against the wall, I was holding a wall up, actually, with my back, and my sitting on the floor, feet out in front of me, holding the wall up, and then fall down. And this guy went crawling by in front of me. I'd never met him before. He's crawling, there's a guitar over there about 9 meters away. And he's crawling for that, you know, guitar. Took him about at least 20 minutes to get there. I mean, you know, moving real slow at that time of the morning. He got the guitar, and he rolled around, put it on his lap, and he's sitting there leaning against the wall like me, and I looked at him, he looked at me. Later on, we became really good friends over the years, very close friends. But I didn't know him at the time, but this is the song he wrote, and this is the song I heard him sing. If I listened long enough to you, I'd find a way to believe it's all true. And even knowing that you lied, straight face while I cry, till I find a reason to believe. Someone like you makes it hard to do without somebody. Someone like you makes it easy to give. Never thinking of myself. If I gave you time to change my mind, I'd find a way, yeah, to leave the past behind. Even knowing that you lied, straight face while I cried, still I look, find a reason. Someone like you makes it hard to live without somebody. Someone like you makes it easy to give. Never thinking of myself. Songs didn't get written because he died, you know, because he must have had hundreds more to come, but he wasn't here to catch them. There was one song he did that, out of all of the tunes he wrote, this next tune is my favorite song. Yeah, I mean, it's just, well, you'll hear it, my favorite song. Almost my favorite song of the whole evening, but not quite. If I were a carpenter and you were a lady, would you marry me anyway? Would you have my baby? If a tinker were my dream, would you still guide me? Would you carry the pipes I made, walk along beside me? Sing my love through loneliness, sing my love through sorrow. I gave you my morning, give me your tomorrow. If I worked my hands in wood, would you still love me? If you answer me, yes I would. Well, I'll place you above me. If I were a miller, and a mill wheel grinding, would you miss that silver box and miss those soft shoes shining? Sing my love through loneliness, sing my love for sorrow. give you morning, give you tomorrow. Troubadour Cafe. And the Troubadour is kind of like this, only not nearly as nice as this place is. It's kind of a dump now. But in those days, it was really a nice place. Yeah, it's a nice place here, isn't it? It's the guy who owns the place. But anyway, I thought, you know, I'm going to stop and have a beer. It was hot, and I was driving. So I pulled over and parked, and I walked into the club. And you know, it's dark inside. It's bright sunshine, you know, summer day outside. You walk in, you can't see anything. It's dark. It took me a couple minutes for my eyes to adjust to the light. And I saw sitting at the bar a friend of mine. I haven't seen him in a while, Arlo Guthrie, sitting there. And I went, oh, hey, Arlo. Oh, McGuire, hey. And I went over and sat down next to him. And I ordered a beer. Bartender brought it over. You know, opened up and filled up my glass. And I reached in my pocket to get my, you know, money, and I didn't have my wallet. I forgot my money. I didn't have any money. You ever do that? Go someplace and you buy something, and then you go to pay for it. Oh, you don't have any money? How embarrassing is that?
Every night. Happens every night.
And so I assume he won't give him any money. No. And Mari won't give me any money. We are two of the brokest guys you've ever met. Well, they give us money, it disappears. I don't know where it goes. It's, you know, I had it. What happened to that $20? I don't know. So they just don't give us any money. But anyway, I was leaving. I was going to go home and get some money, come back and pay for my beer, because I just lived up the street. And Arnold said, where are you going? I don't have any money, man. I'll be right back. Oh, sit down. He said, I'll buy you a beer. Oh, cool. So I sat down, I'm drinking my beer. Well, you know, when your buddy's broke, you can't just buy him one beer. So he wound up buying me about 8 or 9 beers. I never did make it to the beach that day. 10 o'clock that night, a friend came and said, "Hey, McGuire, you need to ride home." And he drove me home. I had to come down the next day and get my car. But I heard a story recently about Arlo. He'd finished doing a show. And when the show was over, he was tired and sweaty, and he's putting his guitar away. And somebody came up out of the audience. "Hey, Arlo, I wrote a song for you. Let me play it for you." Arlo said, "No, no, man, not tonight. I'm tired. I'm going home." "No, no, Arlo, I wrote it just for you. You're going to love it. This is a great song." "No, listen, man, I'm tired. I'm going home. You know, some other time." "Oh, Arlo, but hey, tell you what, I'll buy you a beer, and while you're drinking the beer, I'll sing you the song." Well, what hot, sweaty guy can refuse a deal like that? You know? Arlo, "Okay, but when the beer is gone, I'm gone." So the guy said, "Okay," so we bought him a beer. While Arlo's drinking the beer, Steve Goodman sang him this song. "I'm riding on a city in New York. Yeah, the North Central Monday morning race. I got 15 cars and 15 restless riders. Yeah, 3 conductors, 25 sacks of mail. All along the southbound Odyssey, the dream pulls out of Kankakee. Rolling on past Califomia Dreamin. Train, they have no names. Freight yards full of old black men and the graveyards full of rusted automobiles. Come on with us, everybody. Good morning, America. How are you? And don't you know me? I'm your native son. And I'm the train you call City of New Orleans. And I'm gonna find money when the day is done." Parking, an old man in the club. Yeah, about a penny home, but ain't no one's keeping score. Won't you pass that paper bag that holds the bottle of that? Can you feel them wheels that are rumbling beneath the floor? Yeah, sons of Pullman porters and sons of engineers. Robert Daddy's the magic carpet made of steel. We're the babes of speed, a rocket to a gentle beat, and the rhythm of the rain is always a dream. Good morning, America, how are you? And don't you know me, I'm your native son. Well, I'm the train they call City of New Orleans. And I'm going 500 miles when the day is gone.
Again,
passengers will please refrain.
This train's got the disappearing railroad blues. Good night, America. How are you? Don't you know that I'm an native son? I'm the train we call City of Blue.
Onward, go! Good morning, America, how are you? And don't you know me, I'm an innocent son. I'm the train they call City of New Orleans. And I'll be going 500 miles, I'll be going 500 miles, I'll be going 500 miles. She goes, oh, a harmonica. She, I love to play harmonica. She picked it up, started playing. I thought, wow. And I realized when she started playing that she was the first one to put a harmonica in my hand. And the way I knew that was because I play harmonica backwards. I play it with the low notes on the right side. And everybody else plays it with the low notes on the left side, like a piano. Low notes on the right. You know? But I play it this way because that's the way she plays it. Oh, Mom, you tell me how to play that. The first song she ever taught me.
You make me happy when skies are gray. You never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
Oh, that's nice. So I guess my mom must have been over here, too. Y'all learned her song, anyway. It's a fun little song. That's why I used to play the harmonica like that with the new Christy Minstrels. I'd play, you know. John Sebastian heard me play the harmonica. You know, like that, like I used to play it all the time with the new Christy Minstrels. He said, you know, McGuire, instead of blowing on it, if you would suck on it, you get a whole different sound. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, here, let me show you. So he took my little harmonica and he went.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah. That's good. Good.
Yeah, you know, like, what?
Do some more of that.
What?
More than wee.
Well, give me some boobity boops over there. Boobity boops.
Thank you.
falling child of God. Walking along the road, I asked him, tell me where are you going? This is what he told me.
Yeah, I'm going down to Yasgar's farm. I'm gonna join in a rock and roll band. I gotta get back to the land to set my soul free.
We got to get ourselves.
Here we go.
If they really wanted us to come back. And if they did, then we'd come back and sing a couple more songs. But see, I'm 75 years old. I'm going to be 76 in October. When I leave... Yeah, when I leave the stage, I'm not coming back. That's it. So we thought we'd forget all that foo-foo of leaving and coming back and doing all that stuff. So we'll just sing a couple more songs. If you'd like us to, we'd be happy to do that. Favorite song. I mean, we did a lot of great. And this is not a 60s tune. I heard this on my son's iPod. I was giving him a ride to a doctor's appointment one afternoon. He was sitting over in the passenger seat and he had his earplugs in, you know, and he had his iPod turned up real loud and had his head back on the car rest. And I knew the iPod was rooted out because his sunglasses were going like that to the rhythm of his music. And I thought, what's it doing to his brain, man? His glasses are jumping like that. But then a song came on I really liked. So I unplugged him. Hey, what's that song? What song? That one is playing right now. He told me the name of it. And so I went home and Googled it. I got the lyrics and the chords and listened to the melody a little bit. And I got with John and said, listen to this tune. Now this, like I said, is not a 60s tune. But it should have been. Except that the girl that sang it was probably in diapers in the 60s. I wasn't even around in the 60s. But listen to this song. What John does to it.
Give your heart.
if I could melt your heart. Somehow we wound up backstage Royal Albert Hall. I don't know how we got there. Once again, a bunch of people I didn't know and a room full of people. And we were in the dressing room backstage Royal Albert Hall, and the four lads from Liverpool were out there on the stage doing their Christmas Eve concert for the whole of England. And it came halftime. They came laughing, rolling off the stage all sweaty and happy. They just did a great half, first half of the show. They come tumbling in the dressing room, and it's full of us. There's about nine of us in there. And they opened the door and went, oop, who are all these people? Where are they? Who let them in our dressing room? But they came on in, and we were all from California. We had on cowboy hats and cowboy boots, and kind of looked like John Wayne, you know, howdy, partner, if we're there. But they were really, once they found out we were like traveling road musicians, they softened up and got real friendly and cordial. We started swapping musician stories, you know, I mean, it's the same no matter who you are or where you are. And it was, we just started laughing, and somebody said, well, does anybody have a camera? And this one girl there, oh, she said, I have one. She was like, zip, you know. Zip. I know I've got one. Ah,
right against the wall. So we all obediently lined up against the wall. And click, she got a picture. If you want to see that photo, it's on my webpage. Just go to BarryMcGuire.com, click on the photo gallery, scroll down. And there we all are, dressing room, Royal Albert Hall, 1964, Christmas Eve. I don't see that picture very often. But oh, 2 months ago, I was looking for another photo, and I was scrolling through the pictures, and that photo just stopped, and I had to stop and look at it. All those faces just staring at me. Just that moment caught in light and time. And, you know, there's about 6 or 7 of those people that aren't here anymore. They're gone. And I was looking at John Lennon's face. He was probably about 20 years old then. And I just couldn't believe it. You know, he wrote us, it's one thing to write a song looking forward to your life. But it's a whole other thing to get to where I am in life and sing that song looking back across the years of your life. And I only wish that John could have been here now to sing this song for us, because it would have had a whole different feeling now than it had when he first wrote it then.
All night, so don't stop now. A little guy.
guy showed up in Los Angeles. He came from the Midwest. He's looking for a recording contract. He came to a friend of mine, had a club out there. He had Monday night open mic night. So he sang there at the club, Ledbetter's, Westwood Village. And my friend was up in his office upstairs. His wife was downstairs running the bar on Monday nights. And she called and she says, Randy, you got to get down here. There's a guy here singing. You got to come here and see this guy. So Randy said, well, no, I'm busy. What is he? You got a great singer? Well, no, not particularly. Well, what does he play, great guitar? Not really. Well, then why should I come down and listen to him? She said, because the people love him. Oh, he said. So he came down, he heard the guy sing, and he watched the audience respond to his music. So when he was finished, he got up and said, listen, I'd like you to sing at my club. He said, okay. He said, what's your name, kid? He says, Little Johnny Duschendorf. He says, Little Johnny Duschendorf. He says, that won't fit on my marquee. You need to shorten your name. He says, no, that's my name. That was my daddy's name. I'm proud of it. No, that's my name. That's what it's going to be. So that Friday came, and the sign painter showed up. He said, what do you want to put on the marquee? And so Randy told him to put it up there, and he changed the guy's name, and the guy never said a word about it. But this is one of his times. Almost there, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain, Shenandoah River. Life is older, older than the trees, younger than the mountains. Yeah, blowing like a breeze. Country road, take me home, yeah, to the place. Take me home, our country road. All my memories gather round here. Miner's lady, she's a stranger to blue. Yet dark and dusty, painted in the sky. Taste of moonshine, a teardrop in my country road. And take me home to the place I belong. And West Virginia, my mountain mama. Oh, take me home, country road. I hear her voice in the morning. The radio reminds me of my home far away. Yeah, driving down this road, I get a feeling that I should have been home yesterday. Country road, take me home, to the place, I belong. I'm West Virginia. Take me home. thank the talking button for coming back again. Hey, I'm talking here. We're supposed to come back in 2013, so maybe we'll see you then, okay? If we do, come back. And we'll sing some more songs together. God bless you tonight, everyone.